Rouse's is proud of the creativity and the unparalleled entertainment in New Orleans, and honored to highlight it with their sponsorship of Steppin' Out on WYES.
Steppin' Out is made possible in part by Susie and Pierre G. Villery.
With a lifetime of passion for public television, we're pleased to help underwrite Steppin' Out.
Please join us in supporting WYES-TV.
I'm Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin' Out with updates from the local restaurant, arts, and entertainment scenes. And you can see we have a full house tonight. Joining me, Poppy Tooker, host of Louisiana Eats on WWNO Radio. Hey, Poppy.
Hey, Peg.
We're so glad to see Doug MacCash, who covers the arts and culture scenes for the New Orleans Advocate and the Times-Picayune. Good to see you. Hello, dear.
Hey, Peg.
Frank Maselli's back, and he is the chairman of the American Italian Cultural Center, and the center will be presenting opera in the Piazza at Italia June 10th. And opera singer Sophia Parigi, who will be performing at that event, is with us tonight in our Corman studios to sing. Hey. Also with us, Alan Smason, editor of the Crescent City Jewish News and theatercriticism.com.
Hey, Peggy.
Poppy, we are fortunate to have an addition to the Indian restaurant scene.
Well, Peggy, on the West Bank in Algiers, Plume Algiers is just getting ready to celebrate their first anniversary in business. You have to admire anybody who's done that in this year. But this young couple, right there on Pelican Avenue, just a short distance from the Algiers Ferry, is cooking up some of the most delicious Indian food that you are going to find anywhere. Now, we are talking, of course, about Chef Tyler Stewart and his wife, Merit Kasia, and they have a baby together who is not quite a year old. I don't think the baby's as old as the restaurant. You'll see Tyler and their son, Jules. They met at Carrollton Market, and they were inspired by travels together in India to open up this restaurant. And this style is mostly South Indian, but they have North Indian dishes as well. And oh my goodness, the food's so good. I'm gonna butcher these words, so just bear with me. But this is the shrimp balchow, which is like a really great stew. Perhaps the best okra dish I've ever had is the maggi huli, which is okra that's fried, some of it, and some of it is cooked in a coconut milk. It's delicious. There's green bean thoran. It's very easy for vegans and vegetarians to eat there. Their curried chicken is perhaps one of the best versions of that dish I've ever had. It's all just delicious, one thing after another. Lunch, they serve Thursday through Monday, 11 a.m. till 3 p.m. Dinner's Friday through Sunday, 5:30 till 9. They have a fabulous fixed price dinner that you have to make at reservations for. It's like a feed me thing. And they also serve cocktails and beer and wine. Head over to Plume Algiers. You'll love it.
So it is very much, once again, a reminder, it's to go. There's not a place to sit
no!
down.
No! No, no. A year ago, it was takeout only.
Yes.
But no, they've got a fabulous dining room with murals on the wall and go.
Yes, thank you. I'm behind on that, so I'm glad for the update. All righty, and over to Doug. How fortunate are we to have not one but two major art exhibits? And first of all, Van Gogh. Tell us about that.
Yeah, Van Gogh, the Immersive Experience. It's a welcome to the future sort of experience. It's an art exhibit without any art, at least not any painting on canvas, as you might expect. It's an opportunity to explore Van Gogh, the great neo-impressionist genius. You explore his work through high-tech means. For instance, this is the immersive experience. You sit in a reclining chair or a beanbag, absolutely surrounded by projections of Van Gogh's artwork, animated, and it's wonderful seeing those sunflowers hover in the air and starry night swirl by. It's a wonderful experience. You can also try out virtual reality goggles, enlarged painting reproductions. That's a projection on a bust, a three-dimensional bust of Van Gogh, and it's really pretty marvelous. And there's lots of selfie opportunities there as well. And I want to point out that Van Gogh would certainly approve. The only thing he painted more than sunflowers was himself. The location at the old Scottish Rite Temple downtown is perfect. It was dedicated in 1853, which coincidentally was Van Gogh's the year of Van Gogh's birth.
Wow!
And also, it was originally a church, and Vincent originally set out to be a preacher. So there's a lot of wonderful parallels there. And the artist is perfect. We will love Van Gogh forever. He's the doomed rock star of the arts. He was his paintings fill us with joy, but he was not a joyful person himself. He endured depression and alcoholism and sometimes delusion and self-destruction and eventually suicide. And yet, he has given us all of this beauty and joy.
He certainly has. Doug, I was fortunate enough to be able to see it, and I would really recommend, there are different price points in terms of packages that you can do, but do not miss that virtual reality aspect, because you're actually supposedly walking around in Arles, which is where he spent so much time. But it's worth it. It's a little bit extra. I think the prices go from like maybe the 30s to the 50s, but you're in no hurry. That's the other thing too. Nobody is forcing you out. You know, you have a time ticket, but it's not like, oh, you got to keep moving. You got to keep moving. Because you do get to just sort of sit in these big rooms and see all the, it's an immersive experience. Like that's what they call it. And that building, you're right, is gorgeous. And more recently, it was the Masonic Temple, the Scottish Rite Temple, but what a great adaptive use. And through July, which is good news, too. Like,
oh, that's good. They weren't certain when I first
went. Okay, well, we'll come back to you and talk about NoMA in just a minute, but over to Frank. And Frank, the American-Italian Cultural Center is alive, and we'll be hopping with the not only the museum, and let's talk about that, a newly renovated, fairly newly renovated, but also some opera as well. But talk first about the center, because you spent so many years, you and your dad, Joe Maselli.
Well, those of y'all who aren't familiar, I run the American Italian Cultural Center along with my terrific staff. It was originally founded back in 85, say right after the World's Fair, as the American Italian Museum and Research Library. You know, we've been around a long time. Now, the older generation, which included my dad, Sal Panzica, Nick Accardo, Carlo DiMatteo, and on and on and on, they founded it, and they did a great job establishing it. And so now when they all kind of moved on, passed on, and it was left to me to continue, I converted to the American Italian Cultural Center to give it a little more broad appeal. So we appeal to anyone who likes our American Italian culture. And, our mission is to honor and celebrate the American-Italian culture, past, present, and future. So we honor the culture through our museum. We have a beautiful, professionally done museum up on our third floor that tells the story and history of the Italians, mainly the Sicilians, coming from Sicily back from 1880 on. And actually, the museum even predates that. We go back to the 1600s when the first Italians came over. So we have a great museum, tells the story of the Italians coming over from the beginning and all the way up to the present day and how they evolved.
And I know that also you have some reception area space that y'all recently renovated that you rent out for parties and
That's
different
right.
functions. But it's a really wonderful space, and a lot of care has gone into it. Now, located wonderfully, coincidentally, right behind it is the Piazza d'Italia.
That's right.
And so on June the 10th, you're going to have something very special there. What a great backdrop.
Well, this will be our fifth opera in the Piazza. When I was in Rome about 8 years ago, 9 years ago, I was in the Piazza Navona, and they had a concert going on with, quite a few opera singers just singing arias. And I said, man, this would work perfect at the Piazza d'Italia. So it took me a few years to put it together, but we finally did it, and it's been a big success.
Well, I was there last year, and there was food and drink and, along with, of course, opera. And we're so fortunate because one of your stars, Sophia Parigi, is going to sing for us a little bit. But, Frank, that is a really special night, and there's enough space, too. Everybody, you don't have to feel like you're cramped, do you?
It's a wonderful atmosphere with the fountain, the lighting of the fountain. And you really feel like you're in Italy, in a piazza in Italy.
You kind of do. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And now, moving over to Alan.
Well, Peg, the Bard is back. It's time for the New Orleans Shakespeare Festival at Tulane. And, of course, the first time now that Graham Burke will be taking over as managing director, the job, of course, that Claremont Creef had had for so long. Opening night will be June the 10th for As You Like It, mm-hmm. co-directed by the Radical Buffoons' own Tori Hayward and John Green. And as you may remember, last year they had a wonderful comedy of errors in the summer that was canceled, unfortunately, due to COVID. So it's great to see them both have an opportunity to direct again. Several other openings are happening soon, including Bestival at Bryant Park and the NOLA Project's Schoolgirls. But I want to let everybody know about Choir Boy. This is the rescheduled play that's written by Terrell Alvin McRaney. That's the guy, if you remember, he wrote the Academy Award-winning film Moonlight in 2019. Mm-hmm. This was nominated for a Tony Award for Best Play. So let's check this out. It's coming to New Orleans very, very soon. And again, because of COVID, maybe a little bit delayed, but it should be very interesting to see Choir Boy. And then a little later this month, the musical Bandstand that was also a Tony nominee will be particularly brilliant. Set in the days following World War II, Bandstand deals really with the war widow and a band of pop or jazz performers, all returning veterans from World War II. All suffering in various ways from survivor's guilt and post-traumatic shock disorder. This will be the regional premiere for Bandstand. And then next Wednesday, Ruth Westheimer, that's her, the real one, right on the left there, she's going to be celebrating her 94th birthday. And in honor of that, the Museum of Jewish Heritage is offering a streaming performance of Tova Felch's amazing one-woman show, Becoming Dr. Ruth, written by Mark St. Germain. Beginning on June the 6th and continuing through the 12th, you'll have 5 days to watch this 90-minute show for just $18. I've seen it live back in November, and I can attest to what a wonderful play it was with new scenes written especially for this production. Check it out, Becoming Dr. Ruth.
Thank you so much, Alan. And now back over to Poppy.
Some place that opened up in a spot that I know was special to you, to Alan, to so many people. You remember Le Chat Noir?
Oh. Yes.
Yeah. Well, now, in that same location, there is a wonderful restaurant from the owner of Bearcat, James Reuter the fourth. And so it's right there at 715 St. Charles Avenue. And the food, it has a beautiful sort of a French European twist to it. It's fresh. Look at those anchovies with focaccia, with chili, chive, and lime. The night that we were there, there was a marrow bone special. And anybody who knows me knows I'm all about the marrow bone. The pork belly with rosemary mustard and date puree and the chicharrone. There was quail that night, something that's on the menu that's so divine. There's crab meat agnolotti with oyster cream, scallops, oysters, and crispy prosciutto. That, of course, is bone-in pork chop with kale and crispy shallots. This place has been transformed so beautifully into a restaurant, a dining room with large windows, lots of light. You enter right there at the bar. You can dine in the bar, or there's a dining room in the back. Dinner Monday through Saturday. Wednesday through Friday, there's a happy hour from 3 to 5. And really, it's a special experience. I'd head straight over there.
This is such good news for that neighborhood, too.
Oh, yeah.
And for all of us, but that's really
it's
good
so
news.
So delicious.
Very good. Thank you, Poppy. And now, over to Doug. And we're going to take a look way back for this one, right?
Going back a couple of years, yeah. Nefertari's Egypt is dedicated to arguably the most important queen of the most important pharaoh of the most important era of Egyptian history. She reigned 3,000 years ago, and that's 1,000 years before Christ and Cleopatra. Her tomb was discovered in 1904, and to give you some idea of the grandeur, imagine as you walk through the show that the 6,000-square-foot exhibit is about the same footprint as her tomb. In other words, it was just enormous. Part of this show is about permanence. How can these artifacts have survived for 3,000 years? It's a wonderment. You know, not just the stone, but the wood and fiber pieces. But part of it is about impermanence. This is a funeral exhibit. And the parallels are sort of haunting. This is a riverside culture at roughly the same latitude as us, and you can look for the similarities, like these wonderful, wonderful sandals that look like something you could wear to the beach today. There's a black cat sculpture, an egret that's very familiar, funny little crocodiles, a roast beef jar, which is very strange, the caskets, the craft-making tools, and these doll-like figurines, which are just so charming. You want to reach out and touch them. They would rather you didn't. The show has a subtle feminist slant, trying to emphasize female influences in the culture. And lastly, Nefertari shouldn't be confused with Nefertiti, another queen who came 100 years before. New Orleans' newest Mardi Gras parade is named for Nefertiti. But Nefertari had her own parade, too, from 1975 to 1995 on the West Bank.
Doug, you are good. You are good. I have to tell you that the sandals, I think, was my favorite object of all of them, because they look like it could be worn today.
They really do. And just the craftsmanship to make them, the fine weave, fantastic.
All right. Thank you so much, Doug. And now we are going to the Corman Studios here at WYES, and we're so delighted because Sophia Parigi will sing No One Else from the Broadway musical Natasha, Pierre, and the Great Comet of 1812, and she is accompanied by Dominic Stewart Guido. Take it away.
First time I heard your voice, moonlight burst into the room, and I saw your eyes, and I saw your smile, and the world opened wide, and the world was inside of me, and I catch my breath, and I laugh and blush, and I hear guitars. You are so good for me. I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. And your childlike eyes and your distant smile, I'll never be this happy again, you and I. And no, you remember joy and life inside our souls, and nobody knows, just you and me. It's our secret. This winter sky, how can anyone sleep? the snow in the moonlight. your childlike eyes and your distant smile, I'll never be this happy again. You and I, you and I, you and I. And no one else.
Wow. Oh, congratulations. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Just a reminder, thank you all very much. And we're talking about Friday, June the 10th at 7 o'clock. Sophia will be performing Piazza d'Italia. It's going to be so much fun. And there's all kinds of categories in terms of tickets there, as you see. Go to sophiaparigi.com, and she is available for performances. But let me tell you about Sophia. She is a student at NOCA and the Thomas Jefferson Advanced Academy for Academics. She studies piano at the Jazz and Heritage Foundation, and she also teaches there, too, beginning piano. That's not all. She is music director for St. Christopher, the Martyr Catholic Church, and congratulations, Sophia. Bravo, bravo, bravo. All right, time for our picks of the week. Poppy.
Really?
I think we got Alan.
You know what? Before that, I think I forgot good old Alan Smason. Alan.
And I was just about to say, we'll always have Parigi. So
right,
keep that in mind.
We love that. SophiaParigi.com. Don't forget that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I almost lost you there.
That's okay. If ever there was a sign, though, Peggy, that theater is back, it's when we announce new production companies. So we last week announced Fat Squirrel. This week it's Intramural Theater. They're getting ready to put on an updated version of Sophocles' Electra called The Cook. And again, that's going to be an outside performance at the Treehouse on Feliciana Street. Again, I don't know exactly all that I can tell you about that, but we're going to have a little bit more on that. Sam Meyer is the playwright. Meanwhile, this Monday brings the start of the 3 days of auditions for Stage Door Idol. It's finally back. Hard to believe 3 years since Brittany Williams won the last Stage Door Idol competition. Here she's seen with yours truly. And guess what? This year, the top prize brings you a $2,000 payout. So check that out. Stage Door Idol competition is going to be starting up soon, and the auditions are the 6th through the 9th. I'll be welcoming back past Stage Door Idols to my NOLA Theater talk show on Monday night when those auditions are first starting up. There'll also be some of the stars of the upcoming Blonde Bombshell show they'll be putting on later in the month. And then the following Monday, we'll have representatives from Intramural Theater, the ones I just mentioned, to talk about The Cook, including the playwright Sam Meyer. And Tori Hayden will be on with at least one of his actors to talk about As You Like It for the Shakespeare Festival as well. That's NOLA Theater Talk, again, 8 p.m. Mondays on the 6th and the 13th. And you can see it all on the NOLA Theater Folk Facebook group, the theatercriticism.com Facebook page, and my own YouTube channel. Because he's in Provincetown, Peggy, Seth Rudetsky will be changing the nights for his concerts to Monday nights for the foreseeable future. This Monday night, watch for Mandy Gonzalez, the original Nina from In the Heights, at 7 p.m. And then Tony Yazbek, who was so good in On the Town, will be Seth's guest on June the 13th. Check it out, the Seth Concert Series, about $25 a ticket, and just some great Broadway stars there.
As I've said many times, such a deal, huh? I mean, really, Alex, that is such a great deal. Thank you so much. Now it is time for our Picks of the Week, Poppy.
Don't forget, next week, it's time for the New Orleans Wine and Food Festival. There are still tickets available for those grand tastings Friday and Saturday at the Sugar Mill. And don't miss the war. No, it's the Tournament of the Rosés. I always want to call it the wrong thing. The Tournament of the Rosés on Saturday after the grand tasting ends, right there in front of Manning's on Fulton.
That's going to be so much fun. Thank you. Frank.
Mm-hmm. Well, anyone out there interested in studying Italian language, we have another session starting in about a month, and please check it out on AmericanItalianCulturalCenter.com.
Okay, and thank you. And Doug?
The Historic New Orleans Collection Museum in the French Quarter recently spent a little more than $700,000 for a painting called Asher, Moses, Nathan, and Son, and you should go check it out and be sure to read the backstory.
That is amazing, and which you have done, and it's on NOLA.com, and I'm sure it'll be in the paper as well. It is an incredible story, yes, and very, very important to the history of New Orleans, too, huh? Wow. Alan.
Peggy, the non-equity tour of Waitress, the national tour, will be in New Orleans at the Stanger Theater. And while I like this show on Broadway, the equity tour that came through here a few years ago with great music by Sarah Bareilles and direction by Diane Paulus, sadly, I won't be attending this production. So, Peggy, except for Waitress, I'll see you at the theater.
Okay, thank you so much. And now it is time for my picks of the week, the NOLA Wine Merchant on Magazine Street across from Whole Foods is having a carnival of, we're into rosés, and that's this Friday and Saturday. And they are planning on opening almost every bottle of still and some sparkling rosés, but of course, they will have some available to sell. The tasting is free. Don't miss that. Boy, that's going to be so fun. And I can't wait till the Symphony Book Fair, oh my goodness, woof, at the UNO Lakefront Arena. That is on Friday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. There will be a $15 entrance fee since you get first access, first dibs to the books for sale. On Saturday and Sunday, there's a free admission. And there's so many wonderful things. It's not just books. There's also artwork, DVDs, CDs, and sheet music. And from noon until 2 p.m. on Sunday, all children's books on sale for just $5 a bag. For details, go to lpovolunteers.org. These beautiful works by artists Mary Monk, Billy Solitario, and Peg Usner are among artists' work on view at the newly reopened Christwood Atrium Gallery. And of course, that's on the North Shore, part of the Healing Arts Group exhibition. It's a major show, Christwood's 25th anniversary. A reception will take place on Saturday afternoon from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. 53 works of art by 25 artists. The exhibit will be up through July 30th. Wow, very exciting. Emma Soames, the granddaughter of Winston Churchill, will make two appearances in New Orleans this weekend. She has edited her mother Mary's diaries, which were written during World War II, into a new book, and many of them have never been seen before. She'll be signing Mary Churchill's War on Sunday at 3 p.m. at Garden District Books. You can also buy a ticket, which is for a copy of the book there, too, beforehand, by going to eventbrite.com. And then on Monday, June 6th, D-Day, she'll be interviewed for a conversation with at the National World War II Museum. This is the Orland Russell Corey Memorial Lecture. Corey was a wonderful teacher and supporter of the arts. On Saturday and Sunday at Armstrong Park from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m., two full days of Cajun Zydeco, including Rockin' Doopsie Jr. and Sun Pie Barnes. So go to jazzandheritage.org for a full schedule of that. Food and art vendors will also be there on hand. And the Louisiana Creole Research Association, La Creole, is a local nonprofit family research and educational organization that serves the community by advancing family genealogy research and providing educational opportunities. Those programs are open to the public. For more information, visit their website, lacreole.org, and also you can learn how to support them as well. Thank you all so very much. Thank you, Sophia. You're wonderful. Thank you all. Just a reminder that due to the broadcast of La Mis's 25th anniversary concert, we won't be on next week, but we'll be back June the 16th. Thank you for watching. Good night.
Steppin' Out is made possible in part by Susie and Pierre G. Villery.
With a lifetime of passion for public television, we're pleased to help underwrite Steppin' Out.
Please join us in supporting WYES-TV.
Rouse's is proud of the creativity and the unparalleled entertainment in New Orleans and honored to highlight it with their sponsorship of Steppin' Out on WYES.